Now, Professor Hawking, in the very last paragraph of your book, you say that if we discover a complete theory of the universe, then it should in time be understandable in broad principle to everyone and not just to a few scientists. And when that happens, all of us will be able to start discussing the why rather than the how. And I quote, if we find the answer to that, it would be the ultimate triumph of human reason, for then we would know the mind of God. Do you think that God can intervene in the universe as he wants, or is God too bound by the laws of science?
The question of whether God is bound by the laws of science is a bit like the question, can God make a stone that is so heavy that he cannot lift it? I don't think it is very useful to speculate on what God might or might not be able to do. Rather, we should examine what he actually does with the universe we live in. All our observations suggest that it operates according to well-defined laws. These laws may have been ordained by God, but it seems that he does not intervene in the universe to break the laws, at least not once he had set the universe going. However, until recently, it was thought that the laws would necessarily break down at the beginning of the universe. That would have meant that God would have had complete freedom to choose how the universe began. In the last few years, however, we have realized that the laws of science may hold even at the beginning of time. In that case, God would have had no freedom. The way the universe began would be determined by the laws of science.
Well, thank you very much. And Carl Sagan, in your introduction to the book, you commented on this. You said this is also a book about God, or perhaps about the absence of God, because Hawking left nothing for a creator to do. God, of course, means many things to many people. What sort of God, basically, are we talking about when we talk about reading the mind of God?
Well, I think that's an excellent question, and I'd be most interested to hear Stephen Hawking's answer. But just to try to illuminate the range of possibilities, consider two alternatives. One is the notion popular in the West of God as a sort of outsized, elderly white male with a long white beard sitting in a throne in the sky and tallying the fall of every sparrow. Contrast that with the idea of God in the mind of, let's say, Spinoza or Einstein, which was, at least very closely, the sum total of the laws of the universe. Now, it would be madness to deny that there are well-defined physical laws in the universe. And if that's what you mean by God, then there's no question that that God exists, but it's a very remote God, what the French call roi fainéant, a do-nothing king. On the other hand, the former model, the one who intervenes daily, for that there seems to be, as Dr. Hawking said, no evidence. I think it is wise, my own personal feeling, to be a little humble on such matters. We must recognize that we are dealing with, by definition, the most difficult things to know, the furthest from human experience, and perhaps we will be able to penetrate a little way into these mysteries.
I think, Professor Hawking, you'd like to come in here.
I use God in the same sense that Einstein did. It is really the reason why the universe is as it is, and why the universe exists at all.